It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. It was the age of reason, it was the age of foolishness. It was the epic of belief, it was the epic of incredulity. It was the season of light, it was the season of darkness. It was the spring of hope, it was the winter of despair. And with those words, Charles Dickens opened his classic story of The Tale of Two Cities. It was the story of what happened in London and France at the time of the French Revolution. Because the French Revolution in 1789 was a watershed event, just like what happened recently at 9/11. 2001 was another watershed event. But of course, Charles Dickens was writing about the second great revolution of the 18th century, a revolution which is continuing to this very day. And most people really don't understand that revolution. They don't understand what motivated the march on the Bastille on the 14th of July, 1789. Most people believe, of course, that the king of France at that time was a ruthless tyrant, and that's why the people rebelled. But the truth of the matter is, the reason that things got out of hand was because the king of France didn't have the courage to take a strong stand against the people who were planning a revolution. He knew the revolution was coming. He thought it was going to go away. And by not taking strong action, of course, why he eventually lost his life, as did tens of thousands of other people. If you read the Encyclopedia Britannica, they'll tell you about 3,000 people died in the French Revolution. If you read the classic book, and this is the book which we'll be referring to many times during this program, it was written by James H. Billington, the Librarian of Congress, called Fire in the Minds of Men, and we carry this book. It's one of the five most important books in my library, because it gives you an entirely different slant on the background of the French Revolution. Now, if you have been to college or been to high school, you probably heard that the French Revolution came about because of the philosophies that were put forward in the Enlightenment as people began talking about the right of men to be free, the writings of Rousseau and Voltaire. But as with so much of what you think you know, it simply isn't true. And, of course, it was George Santayana who said that those who cannot remember history are condemned to repeat it. And Thomas Jefferson had said, if a nation expects to live both ignorant and free in a state of civilization, it expects what never was and never will be. If a nation expects to live both ignorant and free in a state of civilization, it expects what never was and never will be. So let me tell you what the Librarian of Congress, formerly the head of the Smithsonian Institute, today the Librarian of Congress, a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, an international scholar, what he teaches his students about the origin of the French Revolution, that watershed event that is being played out today. Because as James H. Billington points out, the French Revolution was the second great revolution in a series of revolutions that swept Europe during the 19th century and culminated in the 20th century, with the Russian Revolution in 1917 and the Cuban Revolution in 1958 and 1959. Of course, those revolutions continue, and you really can't understand why it is that we're not trying to close our borders and we're allowing just unbridled and unlimited immigration into America. You can't understand what we're really doing over in Iraq. You can't understand why everything our government is doing seems to be directed towards destroying the value of our currency. You can't understand anything that's going on today unless you understand the background of the French Revolution and what James H. Billington wrote. So let me summarize what he said. The revolutionary faith was shaped not so much by the critical rationalism of the French Enlightenment as by the occultism and proto-romanticism of Germany. This faith was incubated in France during the revolutionary era within a small subculture of literary intellectuals who were immersed in journalism, fascinated by secret societies, and subsequently infatuated with the ideologies of a secular surrogate for religious belief. The flame of faith had begun its migration a century earlier when some European aristocrats transferred their lighted candles from Christian altars to occult Masonic lodges. The flame of occult alchemy, which had promised to turn dross into gold, reappeared at the center of circles seeking to recreate a golden age. Bavarian Illuminists plotting against the Jesuits, French Philadelphians plotting against Napoleon, and then, of course, the Italian charcoal burners plotting against the Habsburgs. So it's so important that you begin to understand that the foundation of the French Revolution was really in a secret societies and in occultism. And the great tragedy of our time is that most people don't understand that the ongoing world revolution is based in occultism and based upon secret societies. And those of you who have not yet read my book, The Brotherhood of Darkness, let me suggest you get it. It's easy to read. It will introduce you to many of the secret societies, organizations which work within the shadows, determining who your next president will be and how the voting machines are going to be regulated so that their candidate always wins. Well, let me give you an example of how our minds are controlled, because I would like to suggest that most of what you think you believe, or most of what you believe you think is true, really is not true. And let me start out with something that got my attention some 43 years ago when I accidentally tuned into the wrong television program. It was in 1962. I was a young, successful orthopedic surgeon. I came home and I wanted to watch a program. It was called The Naked City. There are 8 million stories in The Naked City. That's how it started. And it was a fascinating detective story, but I got the wrong person. Here was an old man up there on the television screen, and he was talking about the fact that the United States was not a democracy. And he was talking about the fact that Fidel Castro was a lifelong communist, and of course, Fidel Castro had come to power in January of 1959, and we had been told he was an anti-communist, and now by 62 we were told he was a communist, and none of this really made too much in the way of sense. So I had an uneasy feeling that perhaps there was an element of truth to what he was saying. He was talking about how the media in the United States was actually controlled, and we were not able to get the truth from the media or from our educational systems, and it seemed so ridiculous. I got up three separate times to change that television program, and three times I sat back down, and at the end of the program, they had a number they flashed on the screen, and you know, I can always remember numbers, but I couldn't forget that number, and you know, I eventually called and began getting involved with the patriotic movement. One of the things that really impressed me most was the fact that America was not a democracy. Now, I was a graduate of the University of California. I graduated with honors. I had a Phi Beta Kappa key. I really thought I was pretty smart, but you know, as you get older, you begin to realize how foolish you really are because you've accepted what everybody has been telling you. And if you go into the background of this idea that we're a democracy, if you read the Declaration of Independence, the American Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the Federalist Papers, or the constitutions of all of our states, you will find that every one of them says that we are a republic, not a democracy. In fact, if you read the Federalist Papers, you will find that the only thing that says in the Federalist Papers about our form of government is the last thing we want is a democracy. Professor Alexander Tyler, writing in 1789, the year or 1787, the year that we actually formed our Constitution, it was written. Professor Tyler was teaching over at Oxford at the time, and he wrote this: "A democracy cannot exist as a permanent form of government. It can only exist until the voters discover they could vote themselves largest from the public treasury. And from that moment on, the majority always votes for the candidates promising the most benefits from the public treasury, with the result that a democracy always collapses over loose fiscal policy, always followed by dictatorship." And if you read the 10th of the Federalist Papers, which was written by James Madison, he wrote this: "Democracies have ever been spectacles of turbulence and contention, have ever been incompatible with personal security or the right of property, have in general been as short in their lives as they have been violent in their deaths. When we pledge allegiance to our flag, we don't pledge to the democracy for which it stands, but the republic for which it stands. A democracy is ruled by man, a republic is ruled by law. It has been said that a democracy is like two wolves negotiating with a lamb what they're going to have for dinner, and the majority wins. A republic is a situation where two wolves negotiate with an armed sheep, and there's laws against eating sheep. And yet today, most Americans believe we're a democracy because the president says we're a democracy, and that's where in Iraq today. We're, of course, going to establish democracy there. Why would we want to install a democracy when America is not a democracy and has never been one? Is there another motivation behind what's going on today? Another example of misconception is the fact that most Americans believe the United States won the Cold War. I mean, everybody knows that the United States won the Cold War. But if we won the Cold War, why is Mikhail Gorbachev one of those powerful men in the United States today? And why do men like George Herbert Walker Bush, ex-president of the United States, attend his meetings? And we've actually given you a copy of this, and you're in. It's the people who attended the 1995 State of the World Forum. You'll find here that James Baker III, former Secretary of State under George Herbert Walker Bush, is a member of the co-chairman of the State of the World Forum that pays homage to Mikhail Gorbachev. Now, if the United States really won the Cold War, why do our universities pay Mikhail Gorbachev, the former dictator of Russia, who should be tried for war crimes for what happened in Afghanistan when he was the president of or the dictator of Russia? Oh, why do our major universities and other groups pay Gorbachev thousands or tens of thousands of dollars to give talks to them? And why do men like Maurice Strong, who is a multi-billionaire, and Stephen Rockefeller, who is the son of Nelson Rockefeller, why, and both of these men, incidentally, are billionaires, or Rockefeller is the heir to this trillion-dollar Rockefeller Foundation. I mean, if you think that Bill Gates and Warren Buffett are the richest men in the world today, why, you've been reading Time magazine too long. The Rockefellers, the Rockefeller fortune just dwarfs anything they have. But Maurice Strong and Stephen Rockefeller and Mikhail Gorbachev have written something called the Earth Charter, which is, according to them, the new Ten Commandments for the world. It is actually kept today in something called the Ark of Hope, which is a counterpart of the Ark of the Covenant. Now, why would these two billionaires work with a former dictator of Russia to write a new Ten Commandments for the world, which will actually redirect the course of civilization? If the United States really won the Cold War and communism defeated, why do 1.3 billion people live under communism in China today? And why doesn't the media ever refer to China as a communist China, or North Vietnam as communist Vietnam, or North Korea as communist Korea, or Cuba as communist Cuba, or Zimbabwe as communist Zimbabwe, or Angola as communist Angola, or Northwest Africa as communist Northwest Africa? Why don't they do that? Or is our perception being created for us? Is it, as Edward Bernays said in his book on propaganda in 1928, we are governed, our minds are molded, our tastes formed, our ideas suggested largely by men we have never heard of? If we really won the Cold War and communism doesn't exist any longer, why is it that the Russian Duma is controlled by members of the Communist Party? The Russian secret police, they've changed the name, but it's still the secret police, and it's controlled by the Communist Party. The Russian military is controlled by the Communist Party. And Vladimir Putin, you remember when our president said he looked into his eyes and he knew he could trust him, he is still a member of the Communist Party and a colonel in the KGB. So did we really win the Cold War, or have we been told something that really isn't true? In fact, what purpose does communism serve? Well, let me suggest to you that it was Plato writing in his Republic who said this: when the tyrant has defeated the enemy by conquest or treaty and there's nothing to fear from him, then he's always out stirring up a new enemy to rally the people behind him. Or Lincoln Bloomfield, writing in the early 1960s, for the State Department, came up with an analysis of what was going on in the world today, and this is what he said. If the communist dynamic was greatly abated, the West might lose whatever incentive it has for world government. If the communist dynamic was greatly abated, the world might lose whatever incentive it has for world government. And so from 1918 up until 1990, 1991, we had the enemy of communism, but now we have a new enemy. We have the wicked Osama bin Laden. And you remember when the President of the United States promised us he would get Osama bin Laden dead or alive? Well, we've never gotten him. Recently, Portergos, who is the director of the Central Intelligence Agency, was asked during a press conference, do you know where Osama bin Laden is? And he replied, yes, next question. And the reporter said, no, where is he? Oh, well, we know where he is, but you have to understand the diplomatic complexities of this situation. We really have to, well, we can't discuss this openly, classified material ad nauseum. They know where Osama bin Laden is. He's one of the finest enemies that money could buy. So how do we understand what's really going on in the world today? Well, first of all, you have to understand history, and you have to go back and you have to read Plato's Republic. Many of you probably read it. If you went to college and took philosophy 1A as I did, you read it, you were totally bored by it. You didn't understand what he was talking about. It was a lot of verbiage. But if you go back and read it now, and you understand that this is the Mein Kampf for everything going on today. It is basically the plan for a utopian society under the control of a ruling elite. And there are people today who are totally dedicated to establishing a one world order and a new world religion under a ruling elite, and many of these people will attribute directly their ideas to Plato. Now, these ideas were passed down through the millennium, 2,300 years, through secret societies, and we could go into the Templars and the Rosicrucians, but bringing it more up today into what James H. Billington is right about, and you'll find much of what I'm telling you in Billington's book, Fire in the Minds of Men, was actually transmitted to a man named Adam Weishaupt, who in 1776, on May 1st, 1776, created a secret society known as the Illuminati. Now, when people talk about the Illuminati today, people say, oh, you're a conspiratologist, you believe there's conspiracies out there. Of course there's conspiracies out there. There have always been small groups of men who breathe together, who work together for a goal and for an objective. Until you understand that, and don't allow them to put you into a defensive position, the Illuminati existed, and yet you read the 1911 British Encyclopedia Britannica, a lot of information on it, and you read the more modern British Encyclopedia Britannica, while they were still publishing them, why, of course, it wasn't even mentioned, or mentioned only in passing. And yet the Illuminati was a powerful, powerful force here in the United States and throughout the world, and it still exists today. Fortunately, we do have the internet. There's a great deal of false information up there. There is some excellent information. And if you know where to look, why, you can find all sorts of information about the influence of the Illuminati. And what was the Illuminati about? It was an organization that was going to begin to recruit men into this movement to take over all the governments of the world, and to destroy existing religion, and to create a utopian society, as Plato had advocated, under the control of a ruling elite. And then, of course, you'll find other secret societies like that of Buonarroti, and then, of course, the League of the Just, which commissioned Karl Marx to write the Communist Manifesto. Most people think that Karl Marx just sat down and wrote the Communist Manifesto. No, he was actually recruited and financed by a secret society called the League of the Just. But of course, you're not going to read about that today. And then, of course, we find Giuseppe Mazzini in the 1870s headed the group called the Carbonari. Of course, they talked about the charcoal burners. I mentioned the reference to that in James H. Billington's book. Those were the Carbonari. They were a secret society tied into Masonry, and their objective and goal was control of the world. Albert Pike, writing in 1871, in Morals and Dogma, which is still the most widely read book and respected book by Masonry, not only here in the United States, throughout the world. Cecil John Rhodes, for whom Rhodesia is named, actually in 1875 wrote about creating a secret society, and of course Rhodes came out of Masonry. We know the Fabians were organized in the 1880s to bring about a world government. The first communist revolution in 1905 failed, the second one did not. And they had a revolution in March, the second one in October of 1917, and communism was established. But what most people don't understand is that communism, since its very inception, was financed from the United States. And we refer to a book, and of course I quote from it extensively in my book, The Brotherhood of Darkness, but the book is called British Agent. It was written by a man named Bruce Lockhart, who was sent to Moscow, or St. Petersburg, or whatever the capital was at that time, to work with Lenin. He was sent by a man named Lord Milner, who was one of the most powerful men in Great Britain, and just happened to be the leader of the secret society that Cecil John Rhodes had created. And all of this is covered in a book called Tragedy and Hope, A History of the World in Our Time, which is written by a Professor Carol Quigley, who just happened to be Bill Clinton's mentor, who Bill Clinton mentioned when he accepted the Democrat nomination for the presidency back in, I believe it was in July of 1992. And of course, Professor Quigley told Bill Clinton all about the men who really run the world. And if you haven't read Tragedy and Hope, A History of the World in Our Time, you need to get the book. It's very important. It was so important that, published in 1966, someone bought up the publisher, Macmillan, and destroyed the place for the first half of the book. And if you doubt that, we have a tape set over there called The Secret Government, where you'll actually hear Professor Quigley tell you the story of how his book was suppressed. Now, he's not on our side. He believes an elite should rule the world. He would agree with Plato. But of course, at least he felt that the people really needed to understood or understand who these wonderful people were who were working to bring about this one world order. And of course, he ridicules the idea that communism was ever the enemy. And he talks about how all these foolish people following Joe McCarthy, thinking that the communists were responsible for America's incredible foreign policy, which had brought communism to Eastern Europe and communism to China. And he said, you know, that these people honestly believe the communists are behind this. Of course, that isn't the case at all. It is this Anglo-American establishment, which ties back into Cecil Rhodes, that is behind everything that is going on in America today. And he looked upon you and I, people like us, as the petty bourgeois who supported Barry Goldwater, who were concerned about the communists. And communism was never the threat. Well, this is exactly what Bruce Lockhart tells you in his book, a British agent. He tells you he's there, and the headquarters of the communist movement is 1918, and Lenin, this ruthless man who's killed millions of people by this time, is inviting Bruce Lockhart and a man named Robbins, who works for Henry Boyce Thompson from the Federal Reserve System in the United States. The American and the British agent are both there, and they're called into the secret communist meetings, and they're asked for their opinions on what the communists should be doing. Why is this happening? Bruce Lockhart doesn't understand this, but he writes this incredible story, and you see him asking, why are the communists consulting me as a representative of the British government? But then people, of course, really don't understand. Communism has been backed since its very inception by people here in the United States, just as communist China is today. And if you read the Wall Street Journal, as I do, why, of course, you'll find that this major bank is giving $10 billion, and the International Monetary Fund is lending $5 billion, and the U.S. Agency for International Development is guaranteeing a loan for $5 billion for the Chinese communists so they can build nuclear power state plants. Of course, we can't build them here in the United States, but we can guarantee the loan so the Chinese communists can do that. And massive investment in communist China today coming from the United States and from our allies throughout the world who are dedicated to this idea of the New World Order, the New World Religion. We simply quote from Herbert Hoover's memoirs. Herbert Hoover, following the First World War, when there was terrible starvation all throughout Europe and in Russia, and of course Herbert Hoover was appointed by the President of the United States to bring relief supplies. And there was only a very small enclave in Russia that was controlled by the communists. The vast majority of the country was controlled by people who did not want communism, who wanted to be free. Whether they supported the Tsar didn't matter. They did not want to live under communism. And so what happened? Why? Of course, the Hoover Commission, and you can add, we have his book, Herbert Hoover's memoirs, 97% of the food and medical supplies we sent to Russia went to the small area controlled by the communists and 3% to the part controlled by the anti-communists. Now, do you really think that happened by accident? You read General Wrangel's memoirs. He commanded the Army of the South fighting the communists, and the British came in and sabotaged his supplies, destroyed the airplanes he had bought and paid for, and told him he would not get any more supplies unless he immediately evacuated all of his men. If he did not evacuate them and leave the battle, why, they would all be slaughtered. And he never understood why the British wanted the communists to take over. The same thing happened to Admiral Kolchak fighting in the East, and he was undercut by the Americans and by the British. And then, of course, you can read in my book the story that Colonel House tells. And Colonel House, you must understand, is a pivotal figure in this whole incredible story. He tells about how he is in Paris at the Versailles Peace Treaty. And Clemenceau is the Prime Minister of France, and he's very worried about the communist threat in Russia. And the communists are talking about spreading into Europe and coming into France. And so he wants to put down this fledgling communist government there. But Colonel House, and the story actually comes from Colonel House's diary, which I have a copy of. It was released for publication in 1970, immediately bought by Times Mirror, and then copyrighted so it couldn't be printed by anybody else, and then they never printed it. I had to go back to the Sterling Library at Yale to get it. We actually have copies of the whole thing. But Colonel House tells the story how he had breakfast with Clemenceau, and he was able to convince Clemenceau that you should not take any action against the communists in Russia. And then he had a lunch with Orlando, who was the Prime Minister of Italy, who was also concerned about the communists and wanted to put them down. And he convinced Orlando that we shouldn't try to do anything about the communist threat. And then he comments laughingly, of course, I knew it wasn't true. I knew of this small mercenary force and a battalion of artillery. We could put down the communists. But I didn't want Clemenceau and Orlando to know that. We have the pages if anybody wants to check them. You have to understand, we brought communism to China. We financed communism from its inception. If you haven't read Professor Sutton's excellent book, Wall Street and the Rise of and the Bolshevik Revolution, or The Best Enemies Money Could Buy, or seen my interview, and we have one on tape here called The Best Enemies Money Could Buy, where I interviewed Professor Sutton before he passed away. We financed communism. We financed the North Vietnamese during the Vietnam War. How else could you keep that war going against this little country the size of the state of Mississippi? You know, we could have defeated it any time. We never tried. It was a make-believe war. And we lost 58,000 men. And the South Vietnamese lost 1 million people. And the North Vietnamese lost 2 million people. But we began to transform America during the Vietnam War. As the Supreme Court found, there was a right for a woman to have an abortion. The Supreme Court found that, you know, we had to take God and prayer out of our schools, and we began to change our immigration laws and centralize all power in Washington, D.C., and moving from freedom to fascism. So you must understand that time and time again, through the years, why we have helped communism. If you study the fall of China in 1949, you will find out the reason it fell was because the United States government put an arms embargo on the nationalist Chinese so they couldn't buy weapons anywhere in the world and did everything they could to undercut the nationalist Chinese to bring the communists to power. Why? Because we didn't want any challenge to America's dominance of the world. And this is all documented in the book here, and you'll actually read the reports that came out of the United States Senate following the fall of China. Cuba fell in 1959. Why did it fall? Do you honestly think that Fidel Castro won the revolution? No. We put an arms embargo on Batista so we couldn't buy weapons anywhere in the world, did everything we could to back Fidel Castro, and of course, undercut him, Batista, with his own people. We did the same thing in Rhodesia. We did the same thing in Nicaragua. We brought the wicked Ayatollah Khomeini to power in Iran in 1979 using the same technique. We brought the communists to power in Southwest Africa. In Angola, we're working to bring the communists to power today in Zaire and in Nepal. Now, everyone knows that Fidel Castro is the enemy of the United States. I mean, we all know that. We've been told it over and over again. But if that's really true, if Fidel Castro is our enemy, why is it that if you're trying to escape, you're a Cuban, you're trying to escape from Cuba, and you're in a little boat, and you're risking your life to go across 90 miles of open ocean to get to America, to the land of freedom, and only about half the people make it, the rest of them are drowned. But if the U.S. Coast Guard picks you up, they send you back to Cuba, where you'll be sent to prison. If Fidel Castro is really the enemy, why would we do that? If Fidel Castro is really the enemy, why did Bill Clinton and Janet Reno send a SWAT team of 125 heavily armed men to Miami to kidnap Elian Gonzalez from his relatives and then send him back to Cuba to build up Fidel Castro's prestige in Cuba and throughout the world? Why would we do that if Fidel Castro was really the enemy? Why did David Rockefeller, the heir to the Rockefeller fortune, and certainly the leader of the capitalist world, a friend of mine, Congressman William Dannemeyer, told me at a meeting he had with David Rockefeller and half a dozen other congressmen, David Rockefeller said, you know, some men are born to rule, but most men are born to be ruled. David Rockefeller one time asked if he was thinking of running for president. He said, why should I step down? But David Rockefeller had a meeting with, and you can get this out of David Rockefeller's memoirs, and I want to think you ought to get it. It's probably worthwhile reading. David Rockefeller had at least one private meeting with the wicked Fidel Castro. Now, why would David Rockefeller meet with the wicked Fidel Castro? If you read his memoirs, you'll find out that both of David Rockefeller's daughters are dedicated Marxists and support Fidel Castro and travel to Cuba in violation of the laws of the United States to support Fidel Castro. Why would David Rockefeller's daughters be supporters of Fidel Castro and dedicated Marxists? Or maybe Marxism really has nothing to do with the redistribution of the wealth of the wealthy. Maybe it is simply the centralization of power in the hands of a ruling oligarchy, as Plato had advocated, a ruling oligarchy that will rule the world. Now, if Fidel Castro is really the enemy, why haven't we assassinated him? We assassinate people all the time. I've talked to three CIA assassins who were told to kill people. We know that they were able to get somebody to go into the police station in Dallas to kill Lee Harvey Oswald, Jack Ruby. I mean, how did they get him to do that? That's a whole different story, but he knew he was going to be captured. But he was willing to risk his life because he had given an order he couldn't refuse. We know that our CIA has been killing people. If you read the Church Committee hearings in 1972 that killed Patrice Lumumba I think it was Nigeria, that would kill Diem and Nu, President Diem and Nu in Vietnam, President Trujillo of the Dominican Republic. If you read the book we have over here, Confessions of an Economic Hitman, he talks about how our CIA had killed the President of Panama and the president of El Salvador. We kill people all the time, so why have we never tried to kill Fidel Castro if he's really the enemy? Oh, we're told the CIA had a plot. They were going to put powder in his shoes so his beard would fall out. They were going to give him an explosive cigar one time, but they decided against that. Maybe most of what we believe really isn't true. And if you begin to look behind the scenes, and you begin to get into the background of how Fidel Castro came to power, you will find out he came to power because we brought him to power. And how did we do that? Why, we did the same thing to President Batista of Cuba that was done to Chiang Kai-shek in China. We simply put an arms embargo so that they could not purchase any weapons. And then we did everything we could to undercut him. Now, how can we really be sure that's true? Well, in 1980, I went to Palm Beach, Florida, and interviewed Ambassador William Smith, Ambassador Earl T. Smith, I should say, and he was the American ambassador to Cuba at the time that Fidel Castro came to power. And, of course, he told me how we brought Fidel Castro to power. There was no question we brought him to power. And people say, well, if that's really true, what about the Bay of Pigs invasion? Well, the Bay of Pigs invasion was designed to fail. I had an opportunity of talking to the officer who was in charge of the war room at the Pentagon. I just ran into him by accident, and through my life I had an opportunity to meet an awful lot of fascinating people. He told me that there was only one place you could invade Cuba where you'd be sure to fail, and that was the Bay of Pigs. Why? Because it was surrounded by an impenetrable swamp, a thicket. There was no way off the beach, except under one road, and there was an army of 5,000 people ready to get them. They sent those people in to die. They did not stand a chance. They did not get their air cover. They did not get resupplied. And as the officer told me, he said, you know, we were going to hit another beach. And then at the last minute, the very last minute, they changed the landing site to the Bay of Pigs. He said, I and everybody in the war room went out and got drunk because we knew those men were being sent in to die. And they were. But you're never going to hear this elsewhere. And then, of course, after they'd been captured and those who survived, why, we ransomed them back and gave Castro, I don't know, $50 or $500 million, something like that to help, you know, stabilize the revolution. He immediately killed between 10 and 15,000 political prisoners that he arrested, people who had supported the previous regime. Why don't we try him for war crimes? Has anybody suggested that he be tried for those show trials he put on to kill political opponents? When was the last time you heard any American leader say, we ought to try Fidel Castro for war crimes? You know, don't hold your breath. People talk about Operation Northwood. If you haven't read our syllabus, Iraq, the Untold Story, you'll find out that there was a Joint Chiefs of Staff program in 1962 to try to justify an attack, a military attack on Fidel Castro. And, of course, they had all sorts of ideas how you would get the American people to go along with an attack on Fidel Castro. One of them was, John Glenn was going to be shot up in a rocket. We'd blow up the rocket with John Glenn in it. We'd blame it on Fidel Castro. Or we'd have a lot of Cubans dressed up in uniforms like they were members of the Cuban army, and they would have them attack Guantanamo, and then we would kill them all, and we would tell Fidel Castro is trying to attack Guantanamo, or we'd sink one of our ships, or there was a wonderful idea of taking a plane all full of young people going home for the holidays. And of course, you'd actually have the plane land, but they'd have another plane go up, and it would look like that plane was flying over Cuba, and it would put out a Mayday call saying it was attacked by MiG-15s, and the plane would go down, and then the American people would be willing to go to war. This was Operation Northwood. It was classified for a long period of time. It was how they were going to get us into a war, and, well, of course, the incredible thing was that it was okayed by the Chief of Staff. It was okayed by the head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Lemitzer. It went up through the chain of command, and to John Kennedy, President Kennedy's credit, he refused to go along with that. He said, this is wrong. Of course, now you've heard about the Cuban missile crisis. It was as phony as a $3 bill. They'd know that those missiles, the planning for their missiles for many months. I'm old enough to remember June or July of 1962. Now, you have to remember, 1962, John Kennedy had been in office a year and a half. He was extremely unpopular. He was going to lose the congressional elections in November of 1962. So in June or July, Look magazine, which no longer is published because when you tell the truth, suddenly you no longer get advertisers and your magazine goes out of business. But Look magazine published a series of articles about the Cuban missiles and the fact that the Soviets were moving them in. And Senator Keating at that time had pictures of the sites there. They were preparing for the Soviet missiles. And the government kept denying that it was true. They denied it was true, it was denied it was true. And then just a few days before the November elections were to come up, suddenly we found out that the Soviets were sending in missiles to Cuba, and we had the Cuban missile crisis. And we don't know whether there were any missiles on those boats. We never saw the missiles. All we saw was something covered over with big tarpaulins. And what happened was, the President Kennedy were told, oh, he took a strong stand. No, he pulled all of our missiles out of Turkey. He signed a secret agreement that we would never try to get Fidel Castro out of power. That's the true story, the Cuban Missile Crisis. Once again, our perception has very little to do with reality. Now, how did the Cuban Revolution come about? Well, Herbert Matthews, if he wasn't a communist, he'll do to one comes along. He was a reporter for the New York Times. And he went to Cuba and wrote a series of articles about Fidel Castro, comparing him to Robin Hood, to George Washington, and to Abraham Lincoln. Fidel Castro was the Abraham Lincoln of the Cuban Revolution. Of course, we know that Earl T. Smith, was the American ambassador. And these are the things he told me, personally. He told me the State Department knew Fidel Castro was a communist. He said that President Eisenhower and Secretary of State John Foster Dulles knew that Fidel was a communist, that we suspended the shipment of arms to the Cuban government. We refused to send weapons that had been purchased by the Cuban government to them. We suspended shipment of replacement parts for their military equipment. We refused to ship the armored cars that they'd bought and paid for. We refused to ship the 17 training planes that had been promised. State Department officials made public statements to undermine President Batista and supported Fidel Castro. The U.S. State Department asked other governments not to sell arms to President Batista. The U.S. State Department restricted the use of the weapons that we'd given to Cuba to fight communism, but we couldn't use them to fight Fidel Castro. The U.S. State Department told President Batista to stop, you know, putting in a temporary state of emergency. Now, we saw what happened in France recently with the riots going on. What did they do? A state of emergency. They suspended the Constitution. But nobody's suggesting we topple the French government because they did that. President Batista suspended the Constitution for 40 days in Cuba, and we immediately called him a dictator. And what most people don't understand is that President Batista had been democratically elected. So I'm going to give you a quick background of the history of the Cuban Revolution and Batista. And then we are going to take a few minutes, and you're going to see my interview with Ambassador Smith. Rob, would you get that all set and ready to go? Get these things turned on, and don't start playing, though, until we get to that point. Okay. Now, remember the Spanish-American War? Probably most of you don't remember it, but it was 1898. And as a result of this war, which was truly an imperialistic war, why we ended up controlling Cuba and the Philippines and Puerto Rico and all of these countries that had been controlled previously by the Spanish. So in 1902, why the American government, you have term power there, and then the American government granted limited independence to Cuba, but we reserved the right to intervene at any time. By 1928, there was a President Machado, who was in power in Cuba. He was pro-communist, and of course, when his term in office was up, he refused to leave. So by 1933, they had a dictatorship in Cuba. It was a pro-communist dictatorship, and the army said, we've got to do something about it. Three sergeants led a bloodless coup. One of them was, of course, Batista. And immediately, in 1933, the United States government recognized Batista's government and immediately granted Cuba full independence. So obviously we supported what he had done. In 1940, a democratic election was held. Batista was elected and, of course, established a free enterprise system, got away from socialism, and things were going pretty well. But by 1944, while the communists were there, they were working. There was another election. Batista lost the election. They didn't have voting machines at that time, but under any circumstances. By 1948, the new regime, of course, was pretty well corrupt, moving towards communism. Batista had actually left Cuba. He'd come to Florida. He would get out of politics. Cuban military asked Batista if he would run for the Senate. Batista said, no, I'm not going to run for the Senate. I'm through. But they put his name in, running for the Cuban Senate. He was elected. So he went back there and of course, then began to, was there. The regime was totally corrupt. I mean, they were stealing money. They were supposed to be burning money that was outdated, and they were keeping it, and the country was going from bad to worse. So again, the Cuban military asked Batista to take over control, and of course, they had a revolution, and Batista once again became the temporary dictator of Cuba. Now, in 1948, there was a Pan-American conference that was held in Bogota, Colombia. At that time, a young revolutionary named Fidel Castro seized the radio station in Bogota and said, this is a Cuban revolution, and I am Fidel Castro leading this revolution. All of our State Department officials were there. They knew Fidel Castro was a communist at that time, but they certainly didn't want the American people to know that. Well, anyway, it was in March of 1952 that Batista led another bloodless coup. Nobody was killed. And the following year, in July 26, 1953, Fidel Castro led a revolution where they actually tried to overthrow the government. He failed. He was arrested. He was sent to the Isle of Pines, where he had a private room, a car. He could travel. He could do whatever he wanted to. But he was a political prisoner. Nobody was killed. In November of 1954, another democratic election was held with representatives from around the world, held in Cuba, and of course, Batista was elected by the people president. And Batista made one serious error. He turned Fidel Castro loose. And Fidel Castro then, in December of 1956, after going to Mexico, which most of you don't know, but has been a communist country for many, many years, they had their communist revolution back in the 1930s, and he was able to get all sorts of support for his communist revolution there. Incidentally, we're being invaded by Mexico today, whether you know it or not. Anyway, in 1956, in December, Fidel Castro attacked Oriente province with 150 men. Only 12 or 13 survived. One of them was Fidel Castro. And so in February 1957, why Herbert Matthews was sent by the New York Times to Cuba to interview Fidel Castro and came back and announced that he was the true Robin Hood. He wasn't a communist at all. He was the Abraham Lincoln of the revolution. And Herbert Matthews over and over again made the statement, Fidel Castro is not a communist. Articles picked up all across America came to be believed. Of course, then in June of 1957, Ambassador Smith was appointed to become the ambassador. And of course, who do you think that they had brief him about what was going to happen in Cuba? Why, the State Department assigned Herbert Matthews to brief Ambassador Smith. And then, of course, there was an Ambassador Hill, though, who also was very knowledgeable, and he told Ambassador Smith this. You were assigned to Cuba to preside over the downfall of Batista. The decision has been made that Batista has to go. Be very careful. And so, in August of 1957, the communists began attacking civilian targets in Cuba, and Batista suspended the Constitution temporarily, and immediately we attacked him. He's a dictator. He suspended the Constitution. Just like they've done over in France. Chirac did it this last week, but nobody's calling him a dictator for trying to restore law and order. Well, let's go ahead and play my interview. Ambassador Smith was a financier and corporate director. He held appointments from three presidents of the United States during the years 1957 to 1959. He was the American ambassador to Cuba during that tragic time of the Cuban Revolution when Fidel Castro came to power. Ambassador Smith, can you give me the background of your initial briefing from the State Department before going to Cuba in 1957?
I was briefed in Washington for a period of 6 weeks. And during that time, I was asked to make an appointment with Herbert Matthews of the New York Times so that he could brief me. I think this is a special importance because of the fact I don't believe any other American ambassador has ever been briefed by a newspaper correspondent regarding the country to which he was to be appointed to. And it was known at the time that, of course, that Herbert Matthews was a strong proponent of Fidel Castro, and that Fidel Castro was dedicated to the overthrow of the government of Cuba by force.
Now, were you given any inkling of the communist background of Fidel Castro?
I was given plenty of inkling. No, I want to change that. No, I was not. In all the time that I was in Washington, I don't ever recall the State Department saying a good word about Batista, and I don't ever recall them saying a bad word about Fidel Castro.
But did the State Department know about the communist infiltration of Fidel Castro's revolutionary movement?
Oh, I think so. I think it was known from the time of the Bogotazo, which took place in Bogota in 1948. I think the CIA and the FBI and also the Assistant Secretary of State for Latin American Affairs and the head of the Caribbean Division were both in Bogota at the time. So, on active duty for the State Department.
So they knew about the communist infiltration, but they didn't relay this information to you?
Well, that is correct.
What about Mr. William Wieland and Roy Rubottom, who were both in the State Department? What was their background as far as the Bogota uprising, and what part did they play in the bringing of Fidel Castro to power?
Well, as I recall, Rubottom acted as secretary for a... This is now, we're going back quite a few years, But as I recall it, he was secretary of the mission that was down there and was representing the State Department at that time.
This was in Bogota at the time?
In Bogota at the time. It was called a Bogotazo because one of the leaders of the uprising was Fidel Castro himself.
And was this a communist uprising?
Yes, it was always maintained to be a communist uprising.
And
not a communist uprising, but an uprising which was led by the communists and instigated by the communists.
Now, what part did Mr. Wieland and Mr. Rubottom play in the ultimate fall of Cuba in 1959?
Well, Mr. Rubottom and Mr. Wieland were really the top men of what I call the fourth floor. And the fourth floor is a book, and I wrote a book with that name. It must be taken symbolically. It means where the Latin American officers had their desks in the State Department because they were situated on the fourth floor. And Mr. Wieland and Mr. Rubottom were the leaders of the fourth floor. They were the top men. Mr. Rubottom was Assistant Secretary of State for Latin American Affairs, and Mr. Wieland was the head of the Caribbean Division. And they influenced our actions in Cuba by their day-by-day actions. And they were instrumental in doing everything that they could to see that Fidel Castro was removed from office.
That Fidel Castro was removed from office?
Yes.
Or
not
Batista?
Batista removed from office. I think we'll have to redo that one.
All right. Well, did the State Department actively work to bring Fidel Castro to power?
The State Department actively worked through the day-by-day actions of the men who were situated on the fourth floor. They were the people connected with the Caribbean and all of Latin America. The Secretary of State was completely preoccupied with Berlin and Tokyo and Moscow, so that he left everything to the Assistant Secretary of State for Latin American Affairs, who was Mr. Rubottom.
Did Mr. Wieland and Roy Rubottom, who were from the American State Department, know about the communist influence within Fidel Castro's revolutionary movement?
I don't think that Mr. Rubottom and Mr. Wieland knew that Fidel Castro was a communist, but I do think that they were familiar with the fact of his communist activities as a boy, from the fact that he was an active leader in the uprising in Bogota in April of 1948. At that time, I believe that Fidel Castro was only 22 years of age, and there's no question about that he was an unstable youth.
And what happened at the Bogota Uprising in 1948?
Well, the Bogota Uprising was a communist-inspired uprising for the overthrow of Gaetan, I think his name was, G-A-I-T-A-N. And it was a communist-inspired uprising, which Fidel Castro led the youth end of it, and it is very famous in history.
I see. Yes. What did the American State Department do to undermine Batista's position and aid the revolutionary movement of Fidel Castro?
That was done in the day-by-day actions of those on the fourth floor. And the fourth floor must be taken symbolically. That word represents where the officers of the Latin American officers had their desks in the State Department. And in their day-by-day actions, they did everything they could, it seemed to me, to undermine Batista and to help Castro.
So what specific things did they do to undermine Batista?
Well, there were about 20 that I've listed. And as I'll give them to you as they come to mind, if you want me to.
All right, please do.
We'll say one of the main things that was done was when they stopped the shipment of arms in 1958, in March of 1958. Under the MAG program, the United States government was supplying arms to Central America and to Latin America. That is for hemisphere defense. There were 1,980 Garland rifles that were to be shipped. And the Fidel Castro group, the 26th of July movement in Washington, were able to persuade the State Department officials that they should cancel that shipment of arms. Now, the actual loss of the arms did not mean so much to the Batista, but it was the psychological effect which had hurt the morale of the people around him and the army officers and his generals. On the other hand, it was a great psychological uplift to the Castro people because they knew that Batista had lost the support of the United States government.
Well, now then, was Batista able to buy weapons from other countries, or did we try
to
block that?
Yes, he got his weapons from the Dominican Republic, from Trujillo, who was in the dictator at that time in Ciudad Trujillo. And also, the United States asked other countries not to sell arms to Batista. This is really intervention by innuendo.
What about other military equipment that he needed? Was he able to get other specific things? What about parts for his military vehicles?
No, they also stopped the shipment of parts, airplanes. We'd sold 15 airplanes and Batista paid for them. The State Department canceled it. I call it reneging on a deal. And the excuse was that they could use those planes for bombing the revolutionaries, where they were just plain ordinary training planes. Also, the same thing took place with armored cars. We sold them 20 armored cars and Batista paid for them. And we never delivered those. Due to the pressure which was put on the State Department by the members of the 26th of July movement, and they had their representatives in Washington, they had a legal representative, and we were also dealing with other emissaries.
Now, what about Fidel Castro? Where was he getting his weapons?
Fidel Castro was receiving his weapons, a great many of them, from the United States. They were financed by Prio, who was the former president of Cuba, and they were sending planes, landing money, bodies, and rifles, and they were dropping them into Sierra Maestra.
But weren't there laws? Weren't there American laws to prevent this?
Yes, there were laws, but the laws were violated, and we did not. We winked at them.
Well, now it was my understanding.
Well, the State Department winked at them.
It was my understanding that President Batista asked that this be stopped, and that were certain actions taken by our government to stop the shipment of arms from America to Fidel Castro?
Yes, they did take certain actions. Dr. Prio was arrested and put in jail, but he was only there for a short period of time. And he was placed in jail and arrested because he'd broken our laws about helping revolutionaries for the overthrow of the government of Cuba. And in return for which, Batista promised, and he did, renewed constitutional guarantees and lifted censorship on the press. This was done three times while I was ambassador to Cuba. When I say three times, on three different occasions, the president of Cuba.
Mr. William Wieland and Roy Rubottom were high officials in the American State Department. Did they have any knowledge of the communist influence within Fidel Castro's revolutionary movement?
William Wieland was in charge of the Caribbean Division, and he served directly under Mr. Roy Rubottom, who was Assistant Secretary of State for Latin American Affairs. And they were fully informed of everything that was going on in through the Latin American desk and through what I call the fourth floor, which is symbolically represents where the desk officers who represent Latin America were situated. Now, it's a fact that Mr. Rubottom was in Bogota at the time of the Bogotazo in 1948, and he served as secretary to the Ninth International Conference, and he was a delegate there. And that is what Fidel Castro was trying to overthrow. And he was about 22 years of age, and he led the communist uprising attempting to overthrow the delegation.
And that was in Bogota, Colombia?
And that was in Bogota, Colombia.
All right, sir. Now, do you feel that the mass media in America, the newspapers, television, radio stations, gave the American public an accurate appraisal, an accurate picture of what was actually happening in Cuba?
No, I don't think they did. The bearded boys were good copy. Therefore, they seized upon the opportunity. Also, it was the overthrow of a rightist dictator, which they are also dedicated to, many of the media. And so they pictured Fidel Castro as a political Robin Hood, and actually likened him to Abraham Lincoln, many of the press, which was giving a false impression to a young revolutionary who was completely unstable, always had been. When I went to Cuba, I went down very carefully after I'd been there for a month, went through all the police records, went very carefully into his background. And I discussed with many people over there who were not in favor of Batista and also not in favor of Castro, but they knew that Castro would be worse for Cuba than Batista. And Father Kelly, who was the head of Villanova University, told me that when Castro attended his university, he had an accident on a motorbike and was unconscious for a long time, and he doesn't believe that he ever was completely sane after that accident.
And yet this was the man that our State Department seemed to want to bring to power.
Yes, this is the man that our State Department did want to bring into power.
Now, do you think that the New York Times was fair and impartial in its reporting of what transpired?
Well, the New York Times was really responsible for bringing Herbert Matthews back to life and giving him the stature that he had. Shortly after the group of 81 men that came from Mexico and landed on the south coast of Oriente with Fidel Castro, which took place in December 1956, Fulgencio Batista released word that Fidel Castro was dead. So the people in Cuba thought he was dead. They paid no attention to him. By gunboats and by Cuban soldiers who met the expeditionary force, most of them were killed. I think there were only 12 men left with Fidel Castro at that time. Fidel Castro knew that this would have to be corrected. So he contacted the New York Times office in Havana and asked that a reporter be sent out to interview him. This would prove that he was dead and he would also get a chance for an interview. The New York Times received a request from Ruby Hart Phillips, who was the head of the New York Times office in Havana, that they send down a correspondent. They sent down Herbert Matthews. Herbert Matthews spent, I believe, 2 days and one night, had his picture taken. The picture appeared on the front page of the New York Times. This all came out in February 1957, and they printed three front page articles that appeared on a Saturday and a Sunday and a Monday, which likened Fidel Castro to Abraham Lincoln and spoke of him as being a political Robin Hood. Those articles gave Fidel Castro stature all over the world and made it easier for him to get money and support. And of course the rest of the press picked it up because it was good copy, as I said a few minutes ago.
Well, now, were there other alternatives to Fidel Castro? In other words, were there other groups within Cuba that we could have supported and brought a democratic society to Cuba, a free democratic society?
There were other people opposed to Batista, in addition to the 26th of July movement, which was led by Fidel Castro, and in addition to the Directorio Revolucionario, which was the communist group in Havana. They were what I call the legal opposition. They were lawyers. They were good business, they were businessmen, and they were the ones who thought that Batista had outsurged his usefulness, but they also realized that Castro would be worse for Cuba than Batista. So they did not support Fidel Castro or the 26th of July movement. And I'm naming such people as Mario Lazo, who was the author of Dagger in the Heart. He was the outstanding lawyer of the firm of Lazo with Cubas in Havana. Guillermo Belt, who was a former ambassador to the United States from Cuba. Father Kelly, the head of Villanova University, etc., etc.
Now, were there opportunities when we might have supported these people and brought about a free and democratic Cuba?
There were many times when there were viable solutions to the situation in Cuba without Batista and without Castro. The State Department never would support any of those solutions, always for the reason that they did not want to intervene in the foreign affairs of Cuba, whereas I've shown in my book and written, pointed out where we intervene every day positively and negatively and by innuendo. The viable solutions that I mentioned, when the State Department would not support any of them, it was very difficult for me to go ahead. However, the Papal Nuncio told me that he would carry the ball and would go ahead and work on these solutions. However, he would have to have our support. And without our support, he could not go on. So, in other words, the Catholic Church was prepared to go ahead.
Ambassador, what were the viable solutions to Fidel Castro taking over?
Well, there were a number of them, but they're based around the premise that Batista would appoint a provisional government without Castro, and that the papal nuncio would carry the ball, he would talk to Batista, and would arrange for it, and then Batista would leave the country, and we'd have a provisional government. But this provisional government would have to be recognized by the United States and would have to receive arms so that they could carry on. Now, the United States at no time, or I would rather say the State Department at no time would do this or would follow through, because they believed that it would be intervening in the foreign affairs of Cuba, which after all by that time is not, it was beside the point, because we've been intervening continuously, positive and negatively, by innuendo. Now, if we had done this, when you set up a provisional government, then it would have been necessary for us to see that we had honest elections, and that would require landing troops or doing whatever was necessary. Otherwise, we do what we have done here in Latin America and in various places, where we get rid of a rightist dictator and we leave a vacuum for the communists to step in. Had we been willing to support a provisional government, Dr. Marcus Sterling was willing to go on and was willing to be the head of it and only stay in office if he were elected for 6 months and then step down and call for new elections. But you can't just appoint a provisional government and not do anything to support them. You have to maybe land troops, you have to supply arms, and you have to maintain that government in force and to see that elections are honest.
Now, were you instructed by the State Department to tell Batista that he had to leave?
On December 17, 1958, upon instruction of the Defense Department, I went out to Kukini, which is his place outside of Havana, and told him, it took me 2 hours and 35 minutes to tell him that we no longer believed he had effective control and that the United States would look with disfavor upon his remaining perpetually in Cuba. In other words, it took me 2 hours and 35 minutes for me to tell the chief of state to leave his own country and to step down. I also had to tell him that he would not be welcome in the United States, that his family would be, but that we couldn't let him come because we were afraid of the troubles that it would create from the political asylees that were there from Cuba.
I'm going to ask that question over again, if I may. Were you instructed by the American State Department to notify Batista that he must leave his country?
Yes, I was instructed by the State Department to notify Batista that he would have to step down. And it took me 2 hours and 35 minutes to do so. But I must explain this. It wasn't all done in one day. I received communications which went through private sources that were, nobody in the State Department knew what was sent, because it did not go over the regular coded messages. It went through CIA connections. And I had various conversations with Gonzalo Guell, who was both the Prime Minister and the Foreign Minister, and we discussed it together. And of course, after every talk we had, he would notify the President, and I would send a duplicate report, a complete report of full conversations that I had with Dr. Guell. And then finally, on the final day, when I went up to see the President, he knew beforehand what I was going to say, because he had been informed by Dr. Guell, the Foreign Minister and the Prime Minister. But it still took me 2 hours and 35 minutes to get the point across, because I spent a great deal of time pointing out that we appreciated what a great friend he had been to the United States. Any matters that came up before the United Nations, not only did Cuba support us, but the President of Cuba went out of his way to line up other Central American nations and other Latin American nations to support us. And he, the ambassador from Cuba, Dr. Porcho Nuendo, was a valuable friend of the United States. I pointed out all these things. I pointed out the fact that he'd helped us in World War II, that he had been a loyal friend of the United States. However, we felt that he lost effective control and that it would be in the best interest if he left Cuba.
But at that point, was there any other alternative than Fidel Castro?
There had been, for 6 months prior to that, numerous viable alternatives without Castro and without Batista. And I never could receive any support from the State Department. And those viable, those, and when I say I believe they were viable, the Papal Nuncio believed they were viable, and I believed they were viable, and he was ready to carry on with them because he knew that I could not obtain the green light from the State Department.
But at the point where you went to Batista and told him he was going to have to leave, was there any other alternative at that point other than Fidel Castro taking over?
Well, by that, if he left, it was just Fidel Castro was going to take over.
Pure and simple.
Pure and simple.
All right, sir.
And there was no compromise. There was nothing with Fidel Castro. Nobody could control Fidel Castro. Many of the emissaries from the 26th of July movement that were crowding the corridors of the State Department always believed and told our people on the fourth floor that they would be able to control Fidel Castro, that he was a youth who was irresponsible, but that they would be able to control him after he took over. Now, the proof of that, that they couldn't control him, was when Dr. Guillermo Belt, who was the former ambassador to the United States from Cuba, came to me one day and said the strike, which is going to take place on the 1st of April of 1958, will not be a success. And I said, why do you say that? And he said, because the mayor of, not the mayor, but the leader of the revolutionary movement in Havana sent word to Fidel Castro that when the revolution was a success, that they would take over in Havana, and they would appoint the mayor and would take over. Fidel Castro sent word back to them, nobody's going to take over but me. Whereupon they sent back word and said, all right, if you feel that way about it, we will not take part in the strike. And of course, if they didn't take part in the strike wouldn't be successful in Havana, and then it wouldn't be successful throughout the country. This is how we knew, or at least how I knew, that there was no controlling of Fidel Castro. He was going to run the show all by himself.
And once Castro did come to power, did we promptly recognize him? Did we support him?
Yes, we recognized him. I think we recognized him too soon. The policy of the United States had always been that we did not recognize any country that had had a revolution. We did not want to be the first. We did not want to be the last. But we wanted to be in between somewhere. And the United States policy had always been that we want to assure ourselves that they would honor international obligations which had been incurred by the previous administration and that the new government would not be communist dominated. We did not wait for any of these. Fidel Castro came into Havana on the 1st of January, and I was recognized him and gave him his papers of recognition. I think it was either about the 6th of January, maybe it was the 7th of January. It would have been sooner. I was asked to come to Washington so that they could give me the papers, send me back, and I refused to go. That was on the 3rd of January until all Americans had left Cuba. I wasn't going to leave Cuba and take a seat on an airplane or a place on a ship that some American could get out. I wasn't going to leave until it was ready. And when I told him that it was clear now from my point of view to come up, then I flew up. And that was on the 6th of January.
Do you see any parallel between what happened in Cuba and what has recently happened in Nicaragua?
Yes, I believe that Nicaragua is Cuba all over again. Exactly the same things. We are responsible for the removal of Somoza, the same as we were responsible for the removal of Batista. We would not support Somoza. We would not give him arms. We shut off the arms going in there. And we winked at the arms going in to the Sandinistas. But we wouldn't support him. And it actually, some people have said that we didn't support Castro. Even after he got out, we did. We went right on with the subsidy on the exporting of American sugar, which had been done actually since the days of Roosevelt. We continued it through all the regimes there, and we continued to do it with Fidel Castro. And the same support went to the Sandinistas.
And is there a communist influence within the Sandinista movement?
Well, yes. Thomas Borgay, who is the chief security officer and in charge of the police, is a self-proclaimed Marxist. They have a junta there, five of which two are Marxists. They claim the three are conservatives, but there's no proof of that. And all we have to do now is look at the record of what's happened there.
Why do you feel our State Department wanted to topple Batista and bring Fidel Castro to power when he did have a leftist leaning, when there was communist infiltration of his movement?
Well, first of all, we don't have a foreign policy. As ambassador to a foreign country, United States ambassador, I was never told what our foreign policy was. I don't believe we have one. The only policy that I can assure you that we've had so far is for the overthrow of all rightist dictators who are friendly to the United States and anti-communists. And then when we do overthrow them, we aren't prepared to go in and set up elections to see that they're honest. We step out, and that's when the communists step in.
It seems that we always oppose the rightist dictators, and we support the leftist dictators. Is there any reason for this?
Well, the only reason I can give is that they believe a leftist dictator is more progressive.
And by progressive, you mean socialistically inclined?
Oh, yes.
Ambassador? Why is it that we always seem to be opposing rightist dictatorships, whereas we always seem to be supporting leftist dictatorships?
Well, the only answer I can give you to that is because they consider leftist dictators as being progressive.
But certainly aren't they totalitarian?
Say that again.
Certainly aren't these leftist dictatorships just as totalitarian? In fact, many times much more totalitarian and much more ruthless than the rightist dictatorship?
They're worse. All you've got to do is take Stalin, for example, and what goes on in Russia.
All right, sir. What do you think is the future of Central America?
Well, the present future, it would appear we've lost Panama. At least I believe Panama is going to be communist. Nicaragua is. Nicaragua's Cuba all over again. El Salvador was overthrown, and there's a military government there now, but it would appear that the communists are going to take over in El Salvador, Honduras, Guatemala, and Costa Rica. Costa Rica's already in the hands. And then it is possible that they will move on up into Mexico and Venezuela because of the oil.
I see. I'm going to ask that.
Now, and what are we going to do about it? Nothing. The Monroe Doctrine is dead. Our actions have indicated that.
I'm going to ask that again. What, in your opinion, is the future of Central America today?
It would appear Central America is going to be under the communist control, and I see a very bad future. Nicaragua has already gone communist. And then we're going to have El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, and Costa Rica.
What about Panama?
The same pattern is going on. Well, the Panama Canal, the American Canal in Panama, was surrendered to the Panamanian government, which is under the control of Castro and the communists.
What about islands in the Caribbean?
And the islands of the Caribbean, that's also. On the last chapter of my book, which I wrote in 1962, I said that we must be prepared to do something and stop, otherwise eventually we will have a red lake. The Caribbean will become a red lake. In Grenada they moved in. In Jamaica it's practically communist. Guyana is communist. Of course Cuba is communist. So they're closing in on us from all sides. Not only is the Monroe Doctrine dead by our actions, but it's about time that we stood in there and reinforced it.
Now,
reenacted it.
Could Fidel Castro have taken power in Cuba without the active support of the American State Department?
No. Fidel Castro, of course, could not have taken over in Cuba without the support of the Fourth Floor.
What, in your opinion, is the future of America if we continue following the same foreign and domestic policies that we've followed for the past 20 years?
Add one thing, without the support of the Fourth Floor and the press in the United States.
I want to try to begin to make some sense out of all the inconsistencies of what has been said. Disraeli, who was the Prime Minister of Great Britain during the 1860s, wrote a book in 1844 called Coningsby. And Disraeli said this, "So you see, my dear Coningsby, that the world is governed by very different personages from what is imagined by those who are not behind the scenes. And you must understand that there are things going on behind the scenes." And this is what James H. Bellington is talking about in his book, Fire in the Minds of Men. And this is what we talk about. We put together three pamphlets here. They're very, very economical. They're the occult hierarchy, part one, part two, part three, where we actually go into the background of these secret societies that exist today and their impact on the world we live in. Manly P. Hall was the leading Masonic philosopher until he died about 1994. And of course, he wrote in a book entitled The Ancient Wisdom Expects Its, What the Ancient Wisdom Expects of Its Disciples. Manly P. Hall was a Satanist. He was a 33rd degree Mason, but he had written extensively about Masonry long before he ever entered the Lodge, and then went into those secret levels of Masonry that few people ever dare talk about in America today. And this is what he wrote. It is difficult to determine the positions of the ancient initiates. They are the invisible powers behind the thrones of the earth. And men are but marionettes dancing while the invisible ones pull the strings. We see the dancers, but the masters behind that does the work remains concealed by a cloak of silence. Albert Pike, writing in 1871, said this, rival monarchies are bought and sold in these days, become corrupt, and tomorrow perhaps will destroy each other. All that will become the heritage of the temple. The world will soon come to us for its sovereigns and pontiffs. We shall constitute the equilibrium of the universe and be rulers over the masters of the world. James H. Billington wrote another book besides the one I have here. It was called Russia Transformed, Breakthrough to Hope. And this is what he wrote. One of Russia's greatest art historians had told me in all seriousness a year before that all of Russia's troubles had begun when Gorbachev was initiated into a Masonic lodge by Margaret Thatcher during his first trip to London. Now, if you read our little pamphlets, you'll find that Gorbachev's wife has taken several trips to India to consult with Sai Baba. Who is Sai Baba? Why, he is demonically possessed. If you read the book by our good friend Tal Brook, who was actually Sai Baba's right-hand man, the book is The Avatar of Night, Sai Baba had tremendous mystical powers. Why is Mrs. Gorbachev going over to visit Sai Baba? Because Gorbachev is deeply involved with the occult hierarchy that rules the world. And of course, as you begin to read some of the things that he's written, he, Mikhail Gorbachev, the former dictator of Russia, who should be tried for war crimes, has combined with Maurice Strong, who's a multi-billionaire and who until recently was the number two man at the United Nations, and Stephen Rockefeller, Professor Stephen Rockefeller. Now, for those of you who don't know who Maurice Strong is, there's a wonderful article we have in West Magazine. His wife is a witch. He has a 200,000-acre enclave, which he has set aside, where the witches and the shamans and the occultists from all over the world come to Colorado, called La Baca Grande. And you can read a lot about this up on the internet. And of course, the Rockefeller family has been involved with the occult for several generations because, you see, they've been well rewarded for their dedication to the prince of this world. And Mikhail Gorbachev and Stephen Rockefeller and Maurice Strong have written a new Ten Commandments for the world. It's called the Earth Charter. You can get it off the internet or you can contact us. We'll be glad to get you a free copy of it. And there they're, of course, talking about how they're going to redistribute the wealth not only within nations but between nations, equitable distribution of wealth within nations, between nations, equitable distribution of wealth within nations, that's communism, and between nations, well, of course, that's the master plan. That's why we're shipping our jobs overseas. That's why we're shipping our factories overseas. That's why they're running up the price of your oil and gas and electricity. It's to impoverish the American people, to raise your living standards to that of the Bolivian peasant. We want equality for everybody but the ruling elite. And that, of course, is exactly what Plato wrote about. The Earth Charter today is kept in a counterfeit of the Ark of the Covenant because, you see, the Earth Charter, according to Maurice Strong and Mikhail Gorbachev, is to be the new Ten Commandments for the world. You can go up on the internet and verify everything we're saying. The Ark of Hope has been built. It is a satanic counterpart of the Ark of the Covenant. And there the scroll, they write the Earth Charter on a scroll, just like the Ten, well, of course, the Ten Commandments are on stone tablets, but there really is an occult hierarchy that rules the world, and I hope that you'll get these, they're very economical, we put them together, get one or get all three of them together, and then help us get the information out. We are not involved in a political battle between right and left, Democrat or Republican, conservative and liberal. We're involved in a spiritual battle that is being played out on a political, ideological, cultural, economic, educational battlefield, and tragic is that most people have no idea what is really going on today. So let me just point out that this battle has been going on since really the time when, in the Garden of Eden. If you doubt that these people are all together, just read the list, study this list. You'll find that so many of the people who are attending the State of the World Forum are deeply involved in occult religions or alternate religions, or these people band together. We only catch glimpses of what they're doing from time to time. For as Manly P. Hall said, we see the dancer, but the master, of course, who does the work, is concealed by silence. So let me simply end here with one of my favorite quotations. Back of all that foes have plotted, back of all that saints have planned, back of the schemes of men and demons is a higher hidden hand. Warp and woof are heaven created, every pattern good and wise, oft perplexed by earthly standards, but good and wise in heavenly eyes. Though the cause of evil prospers, yet his truth alone is strong, though a portion be the scaffold and upon the throne be wrong. But that scaffold sways the future, for in the dim unknown standeth God within the shadows, keeping watch above his own. God bless you. Thank you very much.